Thank you so much. This actually was a really exciting prompt to think about narrative. I took this opportunity to think back over really 30 years of work that I've been doing. And so what I'm talking about today brings together some very recent research plus some older research in a way that was very satisfying to see it all hopefully cohere together. And hearing the three previous talks has been absolutely fantastic. I think I've been stimulated by the connections between the ideas that I'm going to be going through and how to really productive and the ideas that have been touched on. So I'm super, super excited. So my work, I am in theater and film studies. I do a lot of work on the relationship between theater, film, and other art forms. And also more broadly in philosophy of art, philosophy of aesthetics, and also philosophy of mind and the intersections there, and more broadly performance studies, looking at non-theatrical modes of performance like this event here. And I think you'll see all of those things coming into play here. All right, so I'm gonna start pretty straightforwardly. So there are a number of art forms, of course, that can depict human beings and human events, right? Of course, there are the diegetic forms, the literary forms that do so through words, but then there are the more iconic imagistic forms or mimetic forms. And among those, oops, what happened? What's that called?
Oh, yeah.
Of course, we have painting. So when you have a painting, in this case, it's George III. That is a representation of a human being, but obviously a painting is not a human being, right? It's paint on a canvas, and it's certainly not George III. And if you're dealing with then a sculpture, once again, a sculpture of George III, it's at least more a three-dimensional object, so that the third dimension is not merely represented, but it's still very much not a human being, and not doing any of the things a human being would do. So that distinguishes it quite radically from dramatic performance. So if you've got Jonathan Groff as George III, he is very much a real flesh and blood human being who is representing a human being. Though, of course, still, he is not George III. And in representing a human being, he is engaged in actual actions in a real event, though it isn't precisely the event and they're not exactly the actions that he's representing. So what I want to do here is explore the really deep implications, I think, of that distinction between a means of representation in which you've got real human beings engaged in a real event, right? And as opposed to pictorial forms that depict or signify an event. All right. Or, as the dramatic theorist Berto states, and said in a widely cited quote, in theater, there's always the possibility that an act of sexual congress between two so-called signs will produce a real pregnancy. All right. So, let's start by thinking about the blurry boundaries between fiction and reality in theater, okay? All right, so first of all, when you're in theater, human beings, as we discussed, usually, though not always, will portray other human characters. Sometimes, of course, you can have non-human entities like puppets performing humans, and of course, there are many cases where humans can portray non-humans. But this is a very, very common situation. Right? Again, not the case with other forms. Actors usually, but again, not always, are performing someone other than who they actually are, like Charles III. Again, you have distinctions, you have cases, particularly in performance art and stand-up comedy, where people will portray sitcoms even, where people will portray some version of themselves, whatever that means. Of course, there's been a lot of analysis about what that does mean and is it really yourself. And this is the most significant thing that I want to be focusing on in terms of the event, the actions. Actors really do typically perform at least some of the actions that they're representing. So they aren't simply pointing to something, signifying something, but they're actually making it happen in front of you. Hence the ambiguity of that term perform. They are really performing the actions, right? So some of those, if an actor talks, shouts, laughs as a character, they are really shouting, talking, laughing, right? Crying can be somewhat more, you know, ambiguous. They can really walk, run, jump, shake hands, enter and exit rooms. All those things are real actions. Eat and drink, although sometimes if you're supposed to be drinking booze, you're drinking tea or something else, but it's really, you really are eating, and so if you eat too much, you really will gain weight, you might not want to gain, etc. Alright, so all of that is relatively uncontroversial. These are all actions that the philosopher John Searle refers to as brute force actions, right? But the problematic class of actions, and the interesting, and already I think that's significant, but the contentious class of actions are what speech act theorists, starting with J.L. Austin and then John Searle famously developed these ideas further and differently, call illocutionary actions, or speech acts, right, that have social, real social force. All right, so this sounds all very sort of technical, but it's pretty significant. Because what are examples of speech acts? I'm sure many of you have encountered this before. They are actions like broad institutional actions. I hereby pronounce you, wife and wife, or I name this ship the Queen Elizabeth, whatever that, I sentence you to 10 years hard labor, those sorts of actions. When George III declares war on America, whatever gonna play, war on America hasn't actually been declared. If I marry two people in front of me in the theater, they're not married after the show is over. If I sentence you to 10 years hard labor force, you don't have to work for 10 years, okay? Those sorts of actions. But it goes a lot deeper than that. According to John Searle, anyway, and this has been widely accepted, although I first published against this about 30 years ago and definitively knocked down the argument. I've yet to see any decent refutation. But people continue to wrongly accede to John Searle's theory that all speech acts of any kind are suspended, the illocutionary force of speech acts are suspended. So that even if I say something like, can you please give me that cup, or I love you, or I hate you, or whatever it might be. So assertions, questions, commands, anything like that, there's no force. It's basically a picture of a speech act. Actually, his analysis of them is identical to analysis of something in quotes, right, where it's suspended. It's not, as he said specifically, I'm making the sounds, but I'm not performing any action above the actor making the sounds, okay? And just as an example, he, articulated this theory actually even earlier than 79, because it was published as an article first. And you still have people frustratingly, pointing as if that's fact. As we all know, speech acts, in theater aren't real. But here's, an example. The stage, an area of fictional utterance, is a frame that disengages all speech acts. That's the view. Okay. So I think that's very significant in terms of distinguishing between reality and fiction, and that is a pictorial, in that view, basically the difference between humans and sculptures, performance and sculpture and painting is not very significant. It just happens to be a pictorial form made out of flesh and blood, and that's exactly what people like Searle and semioticians widely applauded and embraced that view. All right, so let's step back a little bit and think, what makes a speech act real, a conventional action that goes beyond just a brute force action? What counts as a real action? To see if what happens in theater, in some sense, can be truer than Searle might let on. All right, so first of all, In order for somebody to, according to Searle, for somebody to really try, to really be doing something, you have to believe they really want that thing to happen. So any speech act is going to have what we'd use in more colloquial terms, an objective or a goal, right? A point. He would say a condition of satisfaction. What counts is it succeeding. So it doesn't matter if it succeeds or not for it to have force. So if I say, can you please give me that cup, and you refuse, it's been a real request and I'm confused. But I've now asked twice for that cup, and you haven't taken it seriously. That's an example of a speech act that did not have illocutionary force. That's a classic example, and what happened that was said in quotes, or you interpreted it as being in quotes, and so you didn't take it seriously. And that's what Searle thinks is happening in all performance, right? All right, so you have to believe, which you apparently didn't, that I really want that cup, right? And then, in order for it to be felicitous, not for it to be successful, but for it to be seen as a real action. And then second of all, if you were to give me the cup, it would have to be because I asked you for it, right? So it couldn't be, for example, and this is an issue with theater, there was a script that said, I say these words, can you give me a cup, and then you're supposed to give me the cup, right? It has to be really because I asked you for the cup, all right? So getting to the nitty-gritty, that's really, what it would take. All right, so now, here is, from my point of view, just it's not even very difficult to knock down, proof that Searle, this idea of the frame disengaging all the locutionary acts is simply wrong. And that is improvisation, which is very common, right? It's a fictional situation, we were talking about that. It's a fictional situation, it's a controlled situation. And yet, speech acts can do exactly what speech acts are supposed to do. So, for example, if you would play along with me, let's imagine that we are in a cafe, you are the barista, and I am ordering a coffee, and that is the coffee that you just poured for me. So, can I please have a cup of coffee?
I'm sorry, this cup of coffee.
Yes, that would be fantastic. Dying of thirst. Thank you. All right, so in that case, he gave me the cup of coffee because I asked for the cup of coffee, right? Let's try it again. Could I please have a cup of coffee?
Yes, you may. What cup would you like?
I would like just a straight decaf cappuccino.
Oh, we've got great decaf cappuccino here.
Oh, not that one. Oh, actually, could I have a banana instead?
That banana is actually my banana.
So there we are. So these actions that went back and forth had to do with, we were negotiating verbally, we were performing actions. He denied a request, which is great. He offered one, I denied one. That's exactly the way speech acts work in any situation. Right, so what we did here is create what I would say, so the only difference here is that I didn't really want a cup of coffee. He didn't even have a cup of coffee, right? So we were creating what I refer to as gain intentions. We were acting on gain intentions. And actually, intentions in the broader philosophical sense, intentional states, which broadly encompasses all kinds of intentions, but specifically objectives here. So the basic premise is that in improvisation, and as in theater and in role-playing generally, what we're doing is we're playing a game. They say, would you play along with me? And then suddenly create that frame. Okay, would you buy in? And then yes, and then we're playing the games. And we both agree to adopt a set of objectives that govern our behaviors while we're in the game. And then once the game is over, it's done. So even there, even the initial sort of institutional actions, I hereby pronounce you man and wife, if within the game I have the authority to do that, we go through it, for the rest of the game, they are married, right? And it would be breaking the rules in some way if they then were to say, we're not married, we don't even know each other, which sometimes can be exploited for a dramatic event. Okay. So the goals are defined then by, and this gets into what we were talking about earlier, in terms of creating a sort of safe space and environment, those goals are defined by the rules of the game. Okay. So there doesn't need to be any, and this is true of any game, there doesn't need to be any external motivation. So it works the same if I'm in theater, if I'm doing a role-playing game, Or if I'm playing chess, I don't have to have any particularly strong desire to get that king. I love that king now. You're playing basketball, and I want to get this ball into that hoop. The reason you want to do that is because you're playing the game. It's built into the game. The same way, if you're playing a character, and the character has certain objectives, then in playing the game, you take on those objectives while you're playing the game. But they become, just as in baseball, or basketball, or chess, you become very much invested in that because those really are your objectives while you're playing the game, right? Same thing in a role-playing game. Those really become your objectives if you are playing the game in a committed way, right? If you really care. And so you're going to have true, honest responses to what's going on. Not pretend responses, not make-believe responses, but it's going to be a real event, okay? And the goals, like in any game, will vary depending on your role. So obviously, if I'm playing in football, I have to be honest, I don't know a lot about football because I don't really know, but I know there are quarterbacks and other things. So whatever the role is, there are going to be different goals that you would have if you're playing chess, then, you know, if you are playing the white parts, then you're going to have a very different goal than if you're playing the black, etc. And then each character that you're controlling has its own actions as well. So that's exactly the same in a performance. So my goals are going to depend on the role that I'm playing. And that role, the terminology in theater is exactly, absolutely, in English, correct. A role is a role, right? As opposed to a signification. And the player abandons the goals along with the role when the game ends. And again, improvised theater is a game. We use that word, play, right? Now, I'm not going to spend a lot of time on this point, because it's more specialized to theater, but scripted theater is tricky precisely for the reason we talked about, because sometimes the actions succeed because you're following the script, and other times because you're actually, you know, performing the actions. A huge amount of training, particularly in the Stanislavski and method tradition, is to achieve a kind of presence and authenticity and responsiveness, even in scripted performance, right? So there are conventions that take a great deal of work and commitment to create, and actors will say, all good, you know, particularly within these traditions, they'll do a lot of improv, and they'll say, all good acting is improvisation. It'll always be a little bit different every time. But there are always going to be certain points at which, you know, Hamlet is supposed to kill Claudius at the end of the play. He can't simply one night say, you didn't insult me so seriously tonight. He's so sweet, I'm not going to do it, right? So there are certain points you're going to have to weigh. Am I going to play the game, or am I going to fulfill the requirements of the script? Okay. So as Sandy Meisner, one of the most famous method acting coaches, famously said, again, these are two very famous quotes. The foundation of acting is the reality of doing, and what I'm arguing, that's usually taken to be either naive, you know, not a very sophisticated person who's read a Searle and understands semiotics, saying, no, he's absolutely right. And acting is the ability to behave absolutely truthfully under imaginary circumstances. That is the core of good improvisation and performance, and good role playing, right, if it's going to mean something. Alright, beliefs are a little trickier though. Alright, so I've been talking about, remember, the intentional states actually encompass intentions and beliefs. And I've been focusing deliberately on intentions because it's easier to say, give me the cup, and you can see the cup. But if I say I'm Hamlet, well, I'm not Hamlet, right? So that's an assertion. And according to Searle, and I think this is plausible enough, that's still a speech act, right? But what it's doing is it's committing me to the truth of a proposition. So that you can say I'm lying if that proposition isn't true, right? If I say I am Hamlet, or if I say it's raining outside, and that becomes a real speech act, particularly if I am, you know, predicting it's going to rain in 5 minutes, so it's a real prediction, then it really means I believe it's going to rain in 5 minutes. And if it doesn't, then you were wrong. And if I said, oh, I just was uttering the words, or that's just because the characters had to say it, clearly that was not a real action, okay? But I would argue, here too, the basic dynamics is exactly the same, okay? That All right, this gets a little bit more technical, but Searle describes these sorts of speech acts as having word-to-world direction with it, which means the world has to fit the word, right, as opposed to word-to-world direction with it. But the basic premise is exactly the same. While I'm not going to believe I'm Hamlet, right, so there's no thought of actually hypnotizing yourself or any broad relativity, you don't have to complete it as this whole idea of any kind of objective truth, though some people have. All we need to do is recognize is in so-called real life, and I put that in quotes decidedly, because theater is, my argument is theater is part of real life, right? In other aspects of real life, there are many situations where we act on a belief that is not our own. Right? Sometimes because we simply are agnostic about that belief. Other times we might even disbelieve it. So examples like if you're a press secretary, if I'm speaking for the president, people don't want to hear my personal opinions. I'm speaking on behalf of the administration. If you're calling a sales rep, you understand they are going to be giving you the company line, right? I'm speaking on behalf of that company. So in that case, I have a choice. We'll get to this at the very end. At a certain point, I can feel ethically compromised by saying things that I think are false. I say, I can't perform this role anymore. But as long as I'm in that role, I am committed to acting on the beliefs that are inherent in the role. So in that same sense, while I'm playing this game, then if I say, if you're not two man and wife, then I can say, but you're married, that's true within the game. Right? Those are the rules of the game, that act on that belief. Right? And there can be really deep questions about, in real life too, how many beliefs do people really, in a deep sense, really hold beyond simply acting on the belief? All right. So Stanislavski, again, tenant to Stanislavski. Any of you who don't know Stanislavski, he is considered one of the great founders of 20th century acting theory, almost a canonical gospel kind of figure, which is problematic in some ways. But in any case, as he famously says, with this special quality of the magic if, which is one of the main tenets of his acting theory, so you should never say, I haven't eaten in 10 days and I'm passing by this loaf of bread that clearly belongs to somebody else. They turn their head, do I grab it? They would say, well, what would I do if I hadn't eaten in 10 days? And et cetera. So with that idea of if, you're not required, obligated to believe or not believe anything. Everything is clear, honest, and above board. So we all understand, just as we understand when the press secretary is speaking about the administration, we understand if I am playing a role in a play, I am acting on those beliefs. There's nothing false or lying about that. But I then see the real implications, and this again gets into that hypothetical thinking and playing the possibilities. What if people had this belief or what if this had actually happened in the world? The speculative. But not just speculative fiction in reading about it, but you're actually living and observing an alternate reality to see how it would work out. So a term that I have developed to describe this function of narrative of fiction, I call it the in-fiction. Okay? The idea is that while traditionally when people analyze drama from a kind of literary perspective, and quickly a semiotic perspective, it is that plays tell stories. And they do. You can extract a story. I don't know a story. I see the play, and then afterwards I can say, I saw a story about Goldilocks and these three bears, whatever. And I can tell you a story I didn't know before. So it does that. But what I'm arguing is at least as important, and I think much more interestingly, the narrative provides a kind of cognitive frame that allows the performers to understand what they're doing, that defines their actions, that defines the game, and even more important, for the audience to understand what the actors really are doing in the here and now of the performance event, right? Which is why when you define, you can define the most fantastic game in the universe, right? It doesn't have to have any particular connection to reality. It becomes its own reality, right? So I call, when you extract a fiction from a performance, I call that the out fiction. That would be the, you know, the signification of what's represented. And the fiction as a structure for action that defines the rules of the game is the infiction. And insofar as you're focusing on the infiction, part of what this helps to explain is what the philosopher Kendall Walton referred to as silly questions. If you're watching a musical, if you're thinking about it analytically, if you're thinking, what is the story that's being told, there can be questions, all right, well, is this character really supposed to be breaking into song? And where is this music coming from, right? And if not, then is this somehow a stylistic way to show that they are speaking? And if they're speaking, what exactly are they saying? And are they really repeating the same thing 20 times? And who are they speaking to? Whereas once you accept the rules of the game, I am playing a game in which I can express myself by singing, and I want to do this, you know, you simply buy into that, and that's how the this world is, right? So you understand what the person is doing, what they're trying to do, and that's what matters. And it allows this really cool event to take place. Right? And you don't even ask yourself these silly questions, because your goal really isn't to extract the story, it's to understand what these people are doing. All right. I'd argue that exactly the same thing happens. Certainly, kids get this all the time with role-playing games. I mean, if you were to ask, what color is that boat, if it's a boat? And how big are you? Are you in an ocean? Are you in a lake? And what exactly? That doesn't matter, right? There's no truth of matter there. There's no there. Which is also why I have problems with the filling in model, where they say, okay, something is minimalistic, but the audience is filling it. They aren't filling it in. They don't need to fill it in, right? They're seeing exactly what's in front of them. They are standing truthfully exactly what's in front of them. What's in front of them is this real event, this real game that's being played. And of course, video games these days are very much the same thing, where you enter into this other world. So briefly here, to get back to the very beginning, I make a distinction between what I call ludic art forms, like performance, and pictorial art forms, like most paintings, and in fact, though they're three-dimensional, most sculptures are fit within this as well. So, as I said, most representational paintings, not all, and most films, not all, by convention, are pictorial. There are two key, I'm not going to linger on this very long, but two key elements that let you know that. As the philosopher Timothy Curry has argued with respect to film, and I think this is pretty persuasive, in film, the audience is engaged in perceptual imagination. I am imagining that what I'm looking at is these people in this room. So that means anything that I would do, everything I see in that room, is in the room. Right? I'm acting as if I'm looking in a room and not at a screen in the middle of a movie theater, right? And as even earlier back, you know, the philosopher Nelson Goodman developed this concept, not specifically with respect to film, in general, certain art forms of certain semiotic systems being visually replete, meaning every single element of that frame as opposed to words, where they're discrete units of signification. In a painting, everything is part of the act. So if you're looking at a film, if you see a cockroach skirting on the floor behind you, you think, oh, there are cockroaches in that person's room. You look at the clock, and there's a clock in that room. If you're in the theater and you see a bare wood stage, and you know there's no brick wall behind it, they haven't put anything up there, and you see the lights up in the ceiling, and you might see then a cockroach scurrying across the stage, you see those as outside of the fictional world. That's not part of that's not within the game that they're playing. And it doesn't produce a big problem for you. Right. And even more broadly, and this is the real power of ludic play, within theater, any object and any action can be redefined within the world of the game. So just as a king in chess, we call it a king, it's that thing, and it's that thing that does what kings do in chess, has some connection, presumably, way back to some original mimetic game. In theater, that mimetic connection is a lot closer, but I can redefine anything. So, for example, certain actions you would never want to perform in the theater, like killing people, which happens all the time in plays. So there are certain actions that might count. For example, if I take my sword and I touch you, then that means that I've hit you and you need to fall down. And so if we're playing this fencing thing and then I do that, then you are obligated to respond in some way. And you can redefine it more wildly. I could say, if I clap my hands, that means that I got you and you need to fall down, right? So you can define any action to do whatever you want. As long as the audience goes along with you, that becomes the new action, the action. So rather than this exact opposite, but what Searle has said is that illocutionary actions are stripped of all force and they just become null and void. The opposite is true. Brute force actions can be imbued with illocutionary force. So actions that are typically brute force, like killing somebody, become illocutionary actions, conventional actions. And so here, through this redefinition of actions, we can create a safe space that becomes a mirror, or what kind of person would maybe call a representative anecdote, that signifies, that refers to some situation in the real world, but within the safe constructs, right? So if you're going to reenact an argument that could culminate in, say, an act of domestic violence, then we can define in advance, okay, if I clap over my head, that counts as actually having crossed that line and attacked something. Significantly, that can still, if they're really invested in the game, produce a kind of psychological trauma. Because it's a real act, and that's something to be sensitive to and aware of, right? Even there. So it's impossible to produce a perfectly safe space. But, you know, you certainly can, you're defining a laboratory environment. All right, so just real quickly, just some examples of you know, ludic versus pictorial. So above we see Frankenstein from the famous, you know, Boris Karloff Wales film. You know, that's fully pictorial. He's at the front of a lake. He's got a flat head. Everything that we see there is in the fictional world. At the bottom, we've got the wonderful National Theater production of Frankenstein from a few years ago with Benedict Cumberbatch. And here, they are not really in this big void with nothing around them. There is this combination of costumes and not costumes and conventional actions and different kinds of actions, and we understand the rules of that game. A famous production of Midsummer Night's Dream in the early 70s by the great director Peter Brook, where when Bottom turns into an ass, he just put a clown's nose and defined that means you are an ass, and within the rules of the game, that's what it was, and it worked perfectly. And it showed, you know, the power of the imagination and the theatrical perfectly. The whole production was done in a thoroughly ludic way. Famous production of Equus, where we have the horses that are clearly in no way, shape, or form real horses on the stage. But when you're wearing those special masks, you are a horse, you count as a horse, those actions count as a horse. You wouldn't even, in this case, you've got a loosely representational symbolic thing, but you wouldn't even need that. You could simply do it by the way you're moving or acting. As opposed to the film, which was a total flop with exactly the same actors, I think in large part because it turned it into a pictorial representation and the whole effect was completely different when you had a young boy blinding real horses in front of the camera, which is a little late about it, becomes something totally different. And then finally, there's one more after this, Curious Incident of the Dog in the Nighttime from 2012. So here, this is a representation of an entire street and a block. We see him going from house to house and visiting different people and talking to people. We understand the convention, it's super clear, it's very well depicted for us, and we completely buy into it. And we don't have to fill it in and say what color is the door and exactly how big is it. And then finally, Hamilton, 2015. So here, first of all, most famously and significantly in this production, it's a production in which people of color who would not have been in those roles at that time fulfill those roles. It is a stupid question to ask, what is, you know, what's going on with you? What is the race of the characters? You understand, they are, these live human beings are performing these roles, and that was a lot of the power, the empowering aspect of it. is we can play these roles, we can do these things, we can reinsert ourselves in history. Now, more recently, people have problematized that very act. And then more specifically, in this particular scene, you've got Thomas Jefferson and Hamilton engaging in a debate in Congress, which becomes a rap battle. They're a classic example of really effective use, ludic use of things counting as. But really exploring the dynamics of what was happening in that world and teaching people a lot about history and challenging ideas of history and so forth. So then the bottom line here, the upshot, theater doesn't merely create a mirror of reality, as Hamlet says, or signify reality, but it constitutes a real but deliberately constructed event. And in this way, it can function as a laboratory or simulation to produce genuine human encounters, generate new knowledge, and test out, this is totally touchy, test out potential solutions to real world problems. And we've seen that explored specifically. There's a lot of theater work these days done. People will use the term applied drama for this outside of conventional theater settings. The great Brazilian director, auteur, Augusto Boal, created whole genres of theater design, community-based, to go not with professional actors in theaters, but going among communities and enacting social acts of situations of oppression, and then having the communities fill in and step into roles and play experiment with different solutions. At one point, he actually was a legislator in Brazil and actually got people together in order to develop new laws through this sort of role-playing encounter, legislative theater, he called it. And then, of course, as many of you are familiar, drama therapy has also become a big thing, and it's tying directly into the nature of theatrical performance and recognizing that power of theatrical performance, not just as a representation, but as an act. So I want to conclude by pointing to and not solving some ethical challenges. The first, I alluded to this before, when to quit. At what point, if you are performing as a sales representative and you know you're selling people all these defective goods, at some point we would find you culpable for staying in that role instead of quitting. Or if you are in a war and you're doing horrible things because you were just following orders, at a certain point we can find you culpable for not quitting. The same thing can happen in a performance event. If you are asked to perform in an incredibly racist play, it's not enough to say, well, that's what my character was supposed to do. You have to think, well, what are the implications of performing that in front of certain audiences, and should you have quit, right? Recently, to get back to the Berto States comment about the real pregnancy, people have become really, finally, after all of these years, aware that acts of intimacy on stage are real acts of intimacy. If, and they can have exactly the same impact that they would do in any setting. So really defining the safe spaces, allowing the performer's agency, creating structures where there really is real honest consent and limits set and all of that, the ethical implications of, in the past, if you were hired to do something, the expectation was the director would simply, whether it's film or stage, it's in the script, you're a professional, you should do it. And most actors would just go along and do it, and some would be highly traumatized afterwards as a result. And then many of you are very well aware of Philip Zimbardo's Stanford Prisoner Experiment back in 71. As it happens, I did my graduate work at Stanford in the 80s. My big thesis directing project was the production of The Persecution and Assassination of Jean Paul Marat, performed by the inmates of the Asylum of Sheraton under the direction of the Marquis de Sade, or the Marat Sade. And actually, I brought in Philip Zimbardo, who was really, really sweet and very helpful. And we did a series of improvs with our cast, because the idea was nobody thinks they belong in an asylum. I didn't want people playing, that they were insane. So they were all wrongly there, and we divided into the nurses, guards, and the inmates, and it really did. It was very, very effective. And even though, that many years after some of the ethics of that original study were brought into question. Very, very, very powerful. But also, as you've seen, contemporary human subjects. Research has been completely redefined, the ethics of it, based largely, among others, but that's one of the key experiments that we're really starting to do. And then the second ethical question, who gets to tell the story? This is an issue that in the last couple of years has become huge, and I've been confronting it myself. Controversies about whether it's possible for somebody from, say, politically a privileged group to step into the shoes of somebody that's not privileged. Then there's the flip side of that, that, you know, could that be a powerful thing to attempt to do anyway, recognizing that it is a game structure? Do you do that for an audience? Is it safe to do that without an audience? What are the very, very rich, complicated questions about doing that? I think, you know, it's far too complicated simply to say there's a simple rule and we should henceforth forbid anything. But we need to take the challenge very, very seriously. Sort of going back in 1961, that famous journalistic experiment that became a movie, Black Like Me, where the white reporter donned blackface, and then, you know, these days the general consensus is, how could you possibly really understand what it means to walk in somebody's shoes that way? And yet, it had some impact, and, you know, we'll have this discussion. Controversies now about cross-ethnic casting, is it okay for a Latinx performer to play an Arab, for a British, black actor to play an African American in the United States who has another experience, for a straight actor to play a gay character, for a cis actor to play a trans character, all those issues. And that gets into the very nature of that porousness, you know, what are we going to allow, I think. And then finally, you know, participatory reenactments that are now becoming quite, more and more wide common. Again, intuitively reflecting the recognition of the power of performance and simulation, you can go to Cajon, Mexico, to the Parque Eco Alberto, and take on the role of an illegal immigrant, and they'll take you through the very torturous, long effort at border crossing with people abusing you. You can go to the Cotter Prairie Interactive History Park for the Follow the North Star Underground Railroad experience, to have that experience. And again, there are debates, questions about the ethics of these. On the one hand, very powerful way to really have you explore and experience these other, you know, subject positions in a really direct and immediate way. And then, but there's no way you could possibly really understand that. All right, so my conclusion. So to recognize that all the world is stage, this is a huge challenge. It's not a denial of reality, right? And it's not any sort of epistemic or ontological relativism. It's actually, I would argue, to live in what Saltz long ago would have called living in good faith. To take responsibility for your reality and your actions within it. And it highlights the active role that we can play individually and to some extent, and most significantly collectively, in shaping and reshaping our social reality. Thank you.
Thank you so much, David. Questions?
Yeah? Hi. Really appreciated that. Thank you. So I was just wondering, I knew you mentioned that, I believe you mentioned like that there are paintings and films that can be ludic and not pictorial.
Yes.
So can you just, what would an example of a ludic film be, or a ludic painting?
Have you seen the film, Jesus Christ Superstar?
No.
Right, so that one, it's not written about that, it deserves to be written about a lot more. So the way that they film that is, instead of like 99% of most movie adaptations, like the Equus one, where they take this highly theatrical work and put it in a realistic setting, they filmed it, they took the actors to Israel, to the desert. It begins with them getting out of a bus, but then they're performing throughout all these different locales among ruins in Jerusalem. So obviously it's not a movie of a play, because there's no audience anywhere watching them. They're all over the place. They're using the real settings in these very wonderful and creative ways, and there's these beautiful vistas, but there's no attempt to create this pictorial representation. So there are these performers on screen who are playing at these roles. There's a combination of loosely historical costumes, like the Jesus character wears this, you know, simple tunic, with people wearing hard hats and carrying guns, and there's helicopters. No issues with that either. It's highly theatrical, but again, not like the what we saw there was an image of a film of the Frankenstein on the national stage. That was filmed theater. This was purely cinematic, taking advantage of all the resources of cinema, but in a highly ludic way. So that's one of relatively few examples. And I think it's interesting that it's so exceptional. There's a lot more pictorial theater, the whole idea of the box set and creating this, you know, the whole tendency in 19th century theater was to create more and more pictorial theater with the proscenium art. Some people have argued basically creating cinema. And then when cinema comes about, it can take over that role, the theater can move back into its more ludic roots. And with art, there's a lot of, I mean, if you look at Miro, if you look at a lot of, you know, Picasso, a lot of that is very ludic. But a lot of animation, not all, Disney is not. Disney is very visually replete. But there's a lot of wonderful animation and cartooning that is much, much more ludic. Just a couple of simple lines.
Last one is
Dogville. Absolutely, that's a really good. And the only reason I didn't bring that up also is that I thought people would be less likely to know it. But it's almost, because it's on like a theatrical soundstage that almost feels more like a filmed play. It doesn't use as many of the resources. That's done very much like that image of Curious Incident.
Yeah.
There's this town that's laid out there in a very theatrical way, but it's very, very good.
Yeah. What's interesting about that film is actually it's just so much more sort of almost traumatic to watch, although nothing is really realistic at all. Or any, I mean, in terms of it's not representative in any stage, but it's, everything about it is just cut so deep. Like, it doesn't at all take away from the emotionality experience. If anything, it's stronger.
I think if the audience can get over those conventions. Many critics rejected it outright, saying, this is just weird, this is a strange experiment. This is like, I've never seen a play. Some people have said, this feels more like a play. It's like, okay, so what? Yeah.
I'm just wondering, are there ludic films that aren't based on plays?
Well, Dogville is.
Oh, that's okay. I wasn't sure what you were. Okay. That was the.
It was with Nicole Kidman.
Okay.
Yeah.
Was it? Okay.
It was quite a
so it was like a straight up movie,
Yeah. So I'm totally convinced by your Oscar arguments, and I think you destroyed it. I had a question about games. It seems to me like broadly there are kind of like two different reasons why you might play a game. One is you might play it to win, and one is you might play it to have a discovery.
Yes.
And it seems to me that a lot of times when we play games to win, that's when we get into these kind of more fraught ethical problems, because there's the perception that there's a winner and a loser in the event. Whereas when you play a game, as children generally do, just to explore or discover, that's when you are able to kind of have a, you know, a more trustworthy experience, and you can push the boundaries further. Is that?
I think the distinction is really, really good. I think that the second part is a lot trickier because there can be many, like the prisoner experiment didn't necessarily say here's winning and here's winning. They simply had roles, and some of those roles were pretty sadistic, and there were power imbalances. And that can happen with kids' games too. Kids can play a game and then they end up, one of them is in tears because they've been horribly abused within the game, right? So, you know, in terms of the winning and losing, it's like in video games, you can play sandbox games that create this world and there's spaces for action that can be really rich and wonderful. But, you know, they can sometimes be traumatic. And often games where you're just playing to win, if you're a good sport, you know, it isn't necessarily traumatic in any way, but fun and power.
No, I totally agree. It's fascinating. Yeah, no, I totally agree. I withdraw my second.
That's Nathan. I'm similarly convinced of your critique of Austin than I expect to be at the beginning. And and I really appreciate the ethical dilemmas you bring up at the end, but so my question is then, if the theater is the real world, right, and there are these real ramifications to what actors do, what does that mean for, like, a play with a really racist character or an abusive character?
Yes.
Like, they still need to be portrayed, right?
Right.
Or they, so what then is the, how does theater deal with that?
Right, I mean, so the huge thing is being willing to take on, which many actors do, to take on a villain role in the course of the play. And then you need to step back in terms of the ethics and think, well, what is the impact of doing this? And the impact of doing this, hopefully, is to have the audience think about the issues the play is exploring, potentially hate you. And that's the thing about, you know, that being willing to take on that role. And audiences love hating people, so that's great. You know, villains are often the most popular character, and they know enough to know the actor isn't the villain.
Right.
You know, so that's what it takes, is them thinking, in some cases, representing a really horrible character can reinforce that character's horrible attitudes, right? If the play isn't framing it in the right way. And in other cases, you know, ideally, it will actually make that even more good.
Kind of going back to, because I did some improv, right? That's a big discussion in improv right now, is even though there is no winning or losing, there's a lot of bad behavior, both in terms of, accents, right? Even choosing to use accents.
Yes.
Are you just stereotyping and making characters? That's not the intent at all, right? Your intent is to show you this other, but the effect is,
yes,
you're often reinforcing these sorts of things. And often, one of the things, like, we would sit down and have these discussions in the group, in the theater, as epic, like, what are problematic things?
Yes.
How do we stop them? How do we stop them in a performance if it happens to
be?
So I thought that discovery thing, right, it's almost like the algorithms, right? We bring all of our bad behavior into that discovery scene.
100%.
But the thing I wanted to ask you, as a philosopher of mind, I'm really happy anytime anyone takes notes at all. And as a woman, actually, I'm really happy whenever anyone takes notes at all.
Oh, yes.
I have to teach him, and I have to make that every semester.
I actually studied with him at Berkeley. In fact, I wrote the first draft of my critique to him for the class of his.
Nice.
And he actually, he gave me an A, and he said, "This is the first paper I've seen where you're totally wrong. Obviously. But it's a good argument."
That's so fun. I don't know if you've seen anything with Chalmers' new book, Peter Chalmers, Reality Plus.
I've heard of it. I've not had a chance to read it.
I haven't either. But he came talk last year. And he's making very similar arguments that virtual reality is,
yes,
real in all of the important ways for kind of the same sorts of things.
Yeah.
We're simulating, I think he might even go further to say, like, the simulations. There's no legitimate differences in the emotions that are brought up in a lot of cases, which might actually be generally different. I don't know. But it seems like it would fit really well with what you're saying.
100%. Yes. Yeah, I actually remember seeing that talk advertised last year. This fits in really well.
Yes, yeah. I remember years ago in the art department, we had a controversy about flaky white. There was a certain kind of paint that had lead in it. It makes flaky white paint. It's a very creamy paint. And I guess I was coming off the Saint or King George, you know, and this idea of in two-dimensional representation, your actors are the paints.
Mm-hmm.
And you're playing with the paint, you know, there's the gesture of the paint, and but the level of representation, you kind of blur over that, and you see the king, and you think about the story of the king and stuff. But at the same time, this has a material basis, the basis of the paint, and in the case of flaky white paint, it's lead paint. And so certainly at a university teaching people painting classes, should professors encourage the use of flaky white paint, or should they say, no, let's use titanium white, and maybe just phase out flaky white entirely? Because, you know, lead can get underneath people's fingernails and they might be painting. painters, if they get attached to the creaminess of that paint, you know, they could have a long history of painting that could produce lead problems. So, you know, people are cleaning the paint brushes with their fingers. So, you know, it was an issue. And I, so I like this idea that, you know, the world is a stage, that there's so many different types of stories that we tell, and then there are materials that go into that story. And certainly we have the human materials of the play, and who are the humans, and what do they bring by, you know, as we know them as actors, and what they've been up to, you know, Louis C.K., and, you know, if he's playing this role that, you know, is, you know, it's the remnants of people's stories come into it. And from there I started thinking about food, because food is filled with material ingredients. Food tells a story, maybe a cultural story, it could be a seasonal story, the story of Thanksgiving, it's all kinds of stories. Heritage stories, family stories, but at the same time, there are these ingredients in the food, ingredients that, you know, have whole stories behind them, and even actors who are sentient beings who are being brought into the story and used in the story unwillingly. So, this, you know, getting in, I remember there was a review, there were two restaurants across the street on Broad Street, and one was a local restaurant, Broad Street Coffee, where every ingredient was very carefully thought about, and it was organic, and it was a vegan restaurant, and, you know, and so that, you know, they had these food options. And across the street, it was Steak and Shake. Neither of these are there, but, you know, Steak and Shake was across the street. And so the food reviewer from the flagpole went to both of them one day, and then wrote about the narrative event that happened in the mouth, which was that it was just wonderful to eat Steak and Shake. What a wonderful feeling in the mouth, etc. And then by contrast, this other one, no, it was a little more like cardboard in the mouth, and ersatz feeling of, you know, macaroni and cheese or something. But the question of the materials was just was just gone from the review, and it seemed like it missed the whole point of this Broad Street Coffee, which was like a play about the materials of the play, and what can we do with them? How can we substitute parts, you know, in order that we can really be thinking about what are the stories going into this tale of our food?
Yeah, there's actually, there have been a number of performance theorists recently who have been working in food as performance. Mm-hmm. It's a really, really interesting. Josh Abrams is one. Actually, one of my students who's writing a dissertation on community-based performance and placemaking. He's writing about Slutty Vegan, the original Slutty Vegan, not the one that's here in Athens,
okay,
in a performative context, and dealing with the history of the food and the history of the location and what it means to the community and all of this. Yeah.
Wow. Okay. Interesting.
I think it's a great question and comment. And thank you so much, David.